Stay tuned for the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the show. Waiting to be profiled is actress Natasha Andrienchenko and actor Rudi Davis. Natasha Andrienchenko comes to us from her native Russia with all kinds of awards. 3 Russian Oscars for Best Actress, the Lenin Komsomol Prize. I knew I'd say that wrong. Yeah. And the Distinguished Artist of Russia. Natasha, at 17, starred with Andrei Konchalovsky in Siberiad, which won the 79 Special Jury Prize at Cannes. Right. Welcome.
Thank you so much. I think you're the best professor of our Russian pronunciation from today on. Congratulations.
You are my professor. You can say all these things for me. Well, how did you get to your first film at 17 years old?
I came to the Institute of the Cinematography. I was accepted there, and when I was a student of the second grade, I was invited to participate in this movie, and I was very fortunate that my master, he let me go, because usually nobody from the students could leave, you know, the class, and he allowed me to do it because it was a wonderful director, Andrei Mikhalkov-Konchalovsky, so I was very fortunate that I could do it.
Did Andrei know that you were in school, or?
Of course,
oh,
yes.
So he
picked me up from the school, yeah.
He asked for you, so he knew there was also a very good actress going to school.
At least I was very, very fat and big.
No.
Probably 60 pounds more than now.
Is that right?
Yes.
Oh. So
maybe because of that he picked me up, I don't know.
Is that what your role was like?
It was a real great, very strong Russian, not only Russian, Siberian woman. They're tremendously open, tremendously full of emotions. They can kiss, then they can hate, then she can break, for example, the glass from the table, you know, and squeeze the blood in order to show to her, you know, future husband that there is no way that she's going to marry him.
Needed to be 60 pounds
yes.
heavier. But from that point on, you made 25 films.
Right.
Did you obviously finish school first, or were
yes.
you making films all the way?
I was making films, you know. The moment I finished my school, I've been already in 5 movies, and a few of them were very, very important in my country.
One of them won the Best Foreign Film
yes.
nomination at,
yes.
at Cannes, was it?
No, it was here.
It was here for
yes.
the Academy
yeah,
Award.
For the Academy Award.
That's right.
Yeah. It was Wartime Romance, the name of this movie. And I think it was in 1985.
Where yeah. was it made?
It was made in Moscow.
Oh, it was. So were all of your films made in Moscow, Russia?
No, in Russia, in many different places. And for example, the last movie we did in Tallinn, but it was also belonged once to the previous Soviet Union. So, but mostly, yes.
But were you making them in Russian language, or did you
yes.
speak English then?
No, I didn't speak English. So when I was offered for the first time to participate in the American movie, it was Peter the Great.
Yes.
I could not speak one word of English.
But I think they did that film in Russian and in English,
no,
did they?
No,
oh, they didn't?
Only in English.
So what did you do?
What did I do? I had a lot of coaches, and I had to understand, of course, what am I saying. And I've been working like for 5 months on my part. So finally, when I fell in love with one of the leading actors, and his name was Maximilian Schell, and I didn't know how to approach to him. So I came to him and said the lines from my part. I'm very angry at you. He didn't understand anything. He said, why? Why did you send me to the monastery?
You didn't understand anything he was saying?
Because I didn't know how to come to him close. So I said, it was the lines from my part. Why did you send me to the monastery? Because I was playing his wife, Eudoxia, and Peter the Great sent his first wife to the monastery.
Just to get rid of her.
Just to get rid of him. And instead of that, he brought me to Hollywood.
He didn't get rid of you. No. Well, what had that film led to a total change in your career? You fell in love?
Yes, I fell in love. And then recently we got married. I mean, not recently, maybe in 1986.
So you've been married quite a while.
Yeah.
Actually, the other thing is, when you were still in Russia, the KGB was very interested in that romance.
Yeah.
Why were they?
Well, you see, at that time, when we met, Gorbachev hadn't come to the power yet. And at that time, it was actually forbidden to be in love or to be in any contact with a foreigner. Because the moment you're in contact, you're declared as a spy.
Right, I forgot that.
And since I was very famous and everybody knew me on the streets and everywhere, they were very, very mad at me because I had this romance very openly. I didn't want to hide anything. I love this man. And so it was very, very dangerous situation.
So do you think they were following you all the time?
Absolutely.
They were?
Yes, they were. And it's all written in our new screenplay. It's a comedy, and we're going to make a movie. It's called The Divorce Tower. So
a comedy.
A comedy, yeah.
But the thing with Mr. Schell, Maximilian, he's a foreigner. Wasn't he accepted in Russia at that point?
Wasn't he
European?
Yes.
But that didn't matter?
No, it doesn't matter if you're American or if you're European, you know. Russia is such a big continent, and as you know, we had the Iron Curtains during the Stalin time. And recently, it's just started to open up. And actually, the situation with Gorbachev coming to power helped me very, very much, helped us very, very much.
Then he could bring you to Hollywood, put you in the monastery here.
Yeah.
That romance and marriage led to another film, Candles in the Dark, which was about Estonia.
This is very interesting. This is about 1988, when Estonia is one of the 15 republics that belong to the Soviet Union. And this republic first got independence. Mm. And it was very, very beautiful because these people, you know, this is the end actually of the picture, carrying these fantastic, you know, candles, thousands of them. They decided to go to the Dome Church where they would celebrate Christmas for the first time in 50 years, because in our country we were forbidden even to celebrate Christmas because it was a communist society. So no belief in God. So these people wanted just to go to celebrate Christmas. And they met tanks on the streets, troops, and black berets. They were ready to shoot any seconds. And nobody was afraid. Even little children, they were singing these songs. And finally, they broke to this church. And in the church, you know, it was so interesting because the church didn't have a roof. So it was like connection with God, with universe, with other countries. And this is the first country, Estonia, that really got independence, and then Soviet Union fall apart, as you know.
So that really touched you at the time. You made the movie in English, though.
Yes.
Your English got better, obviously.
Yes,
and
I
you lost
so.
A lot of weight.
Yeah. Yes.
When you made we have a clip from that movie.
Yeah.
So I, one part of it is your niece comes back to see you. Is that right, in Estonia?
Yeah.
And she wants to know why you didn't leave with her father.
Yeah, with her father.
So do you want, is there anything more to it that we should?
No, just this is a story of an American girl who comes to visit her aunt. I'm playing the aunt. So, and my brother, her father, you know, left for America because he was one of the leaders of Estonian underground.
Oh.
And she sent his daughter to me. And I try to protect her as much as I can because I have an absolutely similar destiny. Because she falls in love with one of the leaders of Estonian underground. And my love was killed at the age of 18. Mm. So I stayed a widow all my life. I try to protect her as much as I can. But finally, I understand her. And this little American girl gives me strength and power to come back to the Estonian underground and to, regain a second breath. And she became again the leader of me.
You.
Of Estonian underground because of this wonderful girl.
So that's part of the clip explaining why you never left. So we'll see that now, Candles in the Dark with Natasha Andrienchenko.
There was a battle here.
Where?
Here. And those 14 brave young Estonians were shot dead. Their bodies are somewhere here, in the grave. Maybe right where we stand.
Nobody knows where they're buried?
No. He was one of them.
I understand that. This is a monument.
Look. There, all their names. All 14.
I can't read it. It's faded.
Enno here. His name was Enno. And I loved him. Your father begged me to come with him. He said that they would kill him, and they did. He said, Marta, your only girl. And you will be a widow all your life if you stay.
But you loved him.
Of course. I still do.
That was your second film with Max.
Yes.
And we have the daughter from your marriage.
Right.
Nastasia.
Nastasia.
Hi, Nastasia.
Hi.
You were in the film as well. What part were you in?
At the end.
Talk in your mother's mic and tell us where you were.
At the end.
And what part did you have?
When I was looking at God.
Ah, just what your mother was explaining. Were you in the church looking up?
Yeah.
When was it? You know the shooting. At what time? Was it difficult for you? Was it?
Yes.
It was what? At 1 o'clock at night?
Yes.
Did you want to sleep then?
Yes, but
and
I
how
didn't.
Was it? How was it working with your father?
Good.
This was your second film with Max. Yes. Are you going on to make more?
I think so. You know, actually this is our third work together, because we made a very interesting performance in Russia, and he directed me in Russian language, and this is a very famous Austrian great author, Jeden von Horvath, and Christopher Hampton translated this piece like, this is in German, Glaube, Liebe, Hoffnung. So in English, it's love, hope, and charity, this piece we did together.
I'm glad you said that, because I couldn't have pronounced that at all. But that was on stage. It was very successful on stage.
It was very successful. And the most interesting thing that Maximilian invited to make the set, as a set designer, great American sculptor, George Siegel.
I think that's so wonderful. How did he decide to choose George Siegel?
Well, because first of all, they're friends, and he's unique, great artist, and fantastic human beings, and he's so looking for something interesting, and it was no money at all. So George just came to Russia in order to understand it, in order to work on stage, and they painted with Max everything together. It was really so much fun.
That's what makes such a big difference, I think, when somebody does that. One of the other projects, you worked with an Oscar-winning director.
Yes. His name is Sergei Bondarchuk.
Because I couldn't say that either. Bondarchuk.
Bondarchuk, yeah.
And he did Quiet Flows the Dawn.
Yes. I'm very happy because he is also my teacher. He taught me in my class, in my drama school.
Oh, he did?
Yeah.
Well, before we leave, we have to leave, I'm sorry, and I'm glad that Nastasia was with us. Where is it easier for you to live? You have homes in Moscow, Zurich, and Los Angeles.
Very truthful. Everywhere. I think I'm the person of this planet. But I love Los Angeles very, very much. That's why I'm here. But I'm so much Russian. And I'm such a patriot. And we have such a troubles with my husband because I'm Russian. I love Moscow very, very much. And I'm so happy for every second when I can be there, when I can make my movies there and speak my own language. And I really love this ground. I think it's very, very
great. That's wonderful. I think that's great. And thank you for being with us.
Thank you very much.
Don't go away, because we'll be right back with Rudi Davis.
Okay.
Hi, we're back, and I'm Joan Quinn. I'm with actor Rudi Davis, who was born in San Francisco. As a child, Rudi traveled the United States with long stops at a New York ashram with his mother, who sang, and his father, who made crafts. This kid was bit by the acting bug at a very early age. Right, Rudy?
Yeah.
How early?
There's a videotape. It's actually a 16 millimeter. They filmed my mother's birth. So 28 hours of labor.
Is that right? So yeah. you were waiting to be on camera for
right,
a long time.
Right. It's like foreshadowing.
Actually, I talked about living in an ashram. Mm-hmm. Was it a cult yeah. kind of situation?
No, not at all. The man I'm named after, he named my older brother Shakti, and my mother had called to have me named, and he died in a plane crash. So I'm named after him. It's Rudrananda, and he studied with Mutananda and Nityananda in India.
Oh.
And my father and mother went and helped build the ashram there with a group of other families. And one of the people, Bruce Joel Rubin, wonderful person, I just did a film with him. So
he was on the ashram too?
Yes, yeah.
That's, was your mother actually singing there or what?
Not there. My parents were traveled around Europe. They took backpacks and they just kind of hitchhiked around and took the Euro rails, and my mother would sing in nightclubs in Greece and stuff.
So. Oh, I see.
And my father made statues. He would make the molds, and he also made candles. I remember we used to go and play with the candle stuff and make all sorts of...
This is so great, because it sounds like a movie.
Yeah, well...
it will be, yeah, I can see that coming. Right. Something else influenced you, your bio said. To be an actor.
Lots of things influenced me. When we traveled around, in a van with my family. I have three brothers. At the time, it was two brothers. And we stopped at this place. My mother and father went to see a movie, Star Wars. And I remember hanging out with this little kid from, I think he was from India. But he would pick up the rocks, and he'd put his hand underneath the rocks. And ants would crawl on his arm, and he'd eat them.
Oh.
And he told me that I should do this, they're really good for you, and I couldn't get into it. But my father and mother got back, and my father takes some underwear and puts it over his head and starts going, you know, Darth Vader, right? And they start acting it out, so as a child, we acted out a lot of things. E.T., I thought, was a wonderful film, and that inspired me a lot.
So it did. And,
yeah.
I was thinking more like Winnie the Pooh.
Yeah, that was it.
Did you act that out too?
Yeah. When I lived in Mariposa. It's up north.
In California.
And, yeah, and we'd drive like 3 hours to go to this movie theater and we'd see Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, that's
so, yeah.
So
yeah.
The ants had something to do with digging honey out of the pot.
Right.
You were kind of like followed around by those things, huh? What, did you ever
from what I hear around town, George Lucas is starting to get together. Star Wars is number 4, and he's starting to get together the first one, so whenever you're ready, I'm ready.
Oh, you're ready.
Yeah.
The big influence.
Yeah.
Did you ever do any stage work?
Yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I started out doing stage work. I did a lot of plays. I was on tour. I went to Canada, New York, Washington, D.C.,
Doing
a musical comedy.
Can you sing?
Yeah, I actually have been playing guitar a lot lately. A friend of mine, Phoenix, is teaching me to play guitar, and...
He also made your clothes,
yeah,
you said,
he
or
did.
Your jacket.
Metamorph. Creations.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
So Natasha, you're learning.
She was great.
Wasn't she?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Can we talk into your mic?
Yeah, she wasn't finished. You should bring her back out. She wanted to talk some more.
You were singing. Mm-hmm. I have to go back to what you were doing so I can get to Hollywood with you.
Right.
Was that before you did a film?
Yeah, well, I used to do plays. So I did The Jungle Book, children's theater, and I would sing and I'd act in, I did like the Philadelphia Story. And
oh, so you really did have mm-hmm. some experience on the stage.
Yeah.
You mentioned your friend Bruce,
mm-hmm.
Joel
yeah.
Rubin, because how does somebody leave Denver
mm-hmm.
with $100 in his pocket and come to Hollywood and then all of a sudden have this big film?
Well, I was hitchhiking around. I left the day after I graduated. And I went to Ohio with my brother. He went to Antioch.
So you went the other way. You hitchhiked the other
way. All the way that way. And then I came out here. I got here and I was kind of hitchhiking around. I went down to Mexico for the eclipse when it happened.
Oh, yeah.
And then I went on a search for Bruce. And I didn't ever remember meeting him because the last time I saw him I was.
Mm-hmm.
But I went to his house. My father told me this story about how Bruce had waited outside. I think it was Mutananda's door for like 3 days or something. So I was like set. I was gonna go and wait at his house for however long it took. And you know, I didn't know what I was doing. I was like, what do I do? I'm here, I'm ready, you know?
Yeah.
And their family is wonderful. The Rubens are wonderful. They took me in and...
But you came with this desire to be an actor, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the next is kind of like your beginning with My Life.
Yeah, yeah, I did a couple of television shows, and I did a movie called Aspen Extreme.
All because of Bruce? I mean, he connected you with people?
He made a connection for me, and he made a deal with me. He said, when you get really big, you come and do my movies.
Did he?
<Yeah.
laughs> So here you are, and we have a clip from My Life.
Yeah.
You must have gotten really big, yeah. Tell us a little bit about the clip.
My character is George, and... I play Michael Keaton's office kid, and I'm kind of not sure about myself, I guess you would say. And so in this scene, I'm just kind of coming in, and I'm supposed to make a tape for him. And it didn't really turn out as well as I would have liked it to. So,
so this is what happens. Yeah. We'll see the clip from My Life.
What next? Telegram.
Hey. George, come on in. Give me a minute, would you? Get the door.
Thanks. Hey, how'd it go? You ready to finish it up?
It's not gonna work, Mr. Jones. It's just not happening, you know? Maybe I'm not the person to do this.
No, no, no. What are you talking? You want to be a filmmaker, right? This is your shot.
I know. I'm sorry. It's just maybe you need a professional. You know, someone who knows how to open people.
No, 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 no. You're great. You're the man, George. I'm sure. Let me see the tape. You got the tape? Let me see it.
It's not very good. I don't think...
Come on. Let's go look at it.
Okay. Oh, hold on. I left my lens cap on. All right, I'm ready. Rolling.
So, did you have to audition for that part?
Yeah.
You did?
I did.
It just didn't fall in your lap.
Yeah, I went in for the audition, and I had it down. Like, I read and, like, I wrote it all out, and I had it memorized and stuff, and I put the thing down. And I was like ready, and the guy goes, where's your sides? And I was like, oh, and I picked them up, and it kind of threw me. And I think that's what they were looking for, somebody who was kind of like thrown by everything,
yeah.
You know, so.
But it was so great, because when I saw the film, I didn't even know who you were, I didn't know anything about it, but that stuck in my mind, you were so real. And I was going, oh, that poor guy,
yeah.
He really, he's got to go through this. Michael Keaton doesn't like what he's doing,
right.
But he wants him to do it anyway, because no one else, who else is going to do something like that? So,
yeah. Also, you had asked before about where I'd studied and what I'd done. I work with a woman, Silvana, who's my teacher out here, and she's incredible. She's
acting
really
teacher?
Like, yeah, she's really helped me to shape my instrument, you know. This is like an instrument, and I just play it, you know.
But does someone tell you how to play it, a director?
I think that with film, it's like, in order to make a brilliant film, it's you have to have a wonderful director,
mm-hmm.
and wonderful actors, and just people, like on the set of My Life, just the people around, the energy on the set was incredible. It's like, I don't know, it's great.
So it's like an orchestra.
It's like a family,
uh-huh.
and you have to make a bond with everybody, and the director and the actor have to be in tune with each other, and the director has to give the actor his space to do his thing, but the actor also has to be able to say, you know, did you like that? And the director should be able to say whatever, you know, this is this and that, and, you know, and then you should be able to.
Since you're there and you're right in Hollywood, what directors would you really like to work with?
Well, right now, I'd really like to work with Jason Cairns is doing a film called The Bird Collector. And some friends of mine are thinking about producing it, Julia and Andrew. And I'd really like to work with him. I'd really like to work with Bruce again. I hope I get the chance to do that. There's so many people, you know.
What about a type? Do you see yourself as a certain type?
No. I'm pretty confident that I can. You know, we all have everything in us, you know. I mean, we all can do everything. It's just the question of me, Rudi, Rudrananda, stepping out of the way and letting that character take my body and do, you know, it's like painting, kind of, you know. This is like a brush. This body is a brush, and I just paint on the screen.
Then do you lose the real Rudi if you're doing that?
I don't think so.
You know what who the real Rudi is? Yeah. If Rudi, because sometimes, you know, you can get into this and forget.
Yeah, you know, sometimes I get into my characters, and I, you know, it's like I'm here and there and.
And then, which one was you?
Yeah.
The one who was talking to me?
They're all me.
They're all me. If you hadn't acted, do you think you would have done something else?
No, I've known that I've wanted to act all my life. And I will sing and play guitar, but I plan on making a kind of film that people feel good when they walk out of the theater.
So no matter what you... whatever happened in your life, you were going to be an actor, and you're there, and you're working toward it.
Yeah.
And we're glad you were with us. Thanks for being with us. It was really fun having you.
I love this. This is great.
Oh, I'm so glad. Kathleen Spiegelman. We'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles.